Little Tales, Robin Hood. Robin Hood is a very lucky little boy. He has lots and lots of toys. His favourite is his bow and arrow. He's an excellent shot. He fires an arrow and hits the bullseye. But Robin has no brothers or sisters to share his toys with. Sometimes he feels quite lonely playing all by himself. He gets ready to fire another arrow. But he's not concentrating. The arrow flies through the air and lands straight down a little mouse hole. Robin reaches inside to find it. And as he does, something very curious happens. The little mouse hole begins to grow bigger and bigger until there's just enough room to crawl through to the other side. Who would have thought such a beautiful forest could be hidden just behind the skirting board of Robin's little bedroom? But somewhere, a little girl is crying. Robin must find her and help her at once. He searches all over the forest. He looks up into the tall treetops and peers underneath all the flowers. Until at last, he finds Maid Marian sitting under a tree.
"Welcome to Sherwood Forest," she says.
She tries to smile and hold back her tears, but it's just no use.
"Why are you crying?" asks Robin.
"The Sheriff of Nottingham, who rules over the forest, won't share his toys with us forest folk," she says. "And we have no toys at all."
Robin thinks this sounds terribly unfair.
Imagine having friends to play with and not sharing your toys with them. Then he has an idea.
"If I could tell the sheriff how wonderful sharing is, I'm sure he would change his mind," he says.
Maid Marian promises to help. So they set off through the forest to the sheriff's castle. Along the way, they meet Friar Tuck and his best friend, Little John. They are having an imaginary sword fight. It's quite a sight. They ask Robin and Maid Marian if they would like to play.
"No, thank you," says Maid Marian. "We're on our way to see the sheriff to ask if he will share his toys."
Friar Tuck and Little John think they are very brave. The sheriff can be quite a grump. But they promise to help all the same.
"The more the merrier," says Robin.
So together they carry on through the forest all the way to the sheriff's castle. At long last they arrive at the castle. But the drawbridge is up. However will they cross the moat? Luckily, Little John is very clever and very strong. He takes Friar Tuck's belt and ties it into a lasso. Then he throws it over the drawbridge. He heaves and heaves with all his might, and down it comes. Now they can cross the moat and go into the castle. They find the sheriff playing all alone. Maid Marian, Friar Tuck and Little John have never seen so many toys.
"Can we play too?" asks Robin.
"No," says the sheriff. "These are my toys."
He hides them all away in his big toy chest and locks it shut.
Sheriff, this is very unfair, says Robin.
Fine, I'll make it fair, says the sheriff. I challenge you to an archery contest. If you win, I will share all my toys with the forest folk. But if I win, you will be my servants. The sheriff just loves competitions, especially when he thinks he will win.
Robin bravely agrees to take part. But poor Maid Marian is very worried. She knows the sheriff is an excellent shot.
But first, Robin needs a bow of his own. Friar Tuck and Little John search the forest for strong and sturdy sticks. Maid Marian finds a long vine. She pulls off the leaves one by one. Robin carefully ties together the strongest sticks to make the bow. Then he ties on the vine to make the string. And in no time at all, Robin has a bow all of his very own. Little John sets up the target ready for the contest. The first one to hit the bullseye is the winner. The sheriff goes first. Poor Maid Marian can hardly bear to watch. He fires his arrow and it lands very close to the bullseye. Now it's Robin's turn to try his luck. He fires his arrow and he misses the target completely. Poor Robin. His friends look very worried indeed. The sheriff tries again. He fires his arrow and this time it lands even closer to the bullseye. Now it's Robin's turn.
You can do it!
Shout his friends. Robin steadies his shaking hands. He takes a deep breath. Then he fires his arrow. It flies through the air and it hits the bullseye. Robin is the winner. Everyone is so happy. Apart from the sheriff, of course. You won fair and square, he says. So I suppose you can play with my toys. Robin shoots an arrow at the toy chest, and all the toys come tumbling out. Little John and Friar Tuck can have a proper sword fight at last. Robin and Maid Marian set up the skittles, ready for a game. But the sheriff sulks and refuses to play. Everyone is having such fun. So it's not very long before the sheriff just has to join in. Soon he realizes it is much better to share your toys and have friends to play with than to keep all your toys to yourself. The sheriff promises from this day on he will always share with the forest folk. They spend a lovely afternoon together, sharing nicely and taking turns with all of the toys. It seems like no time at all before Robin has to go home. He says goodbye to all his new friends before crawling through the little mouse hole. Robin had the most wonderful time in Sherwood Forest. But he misses his new friends terribly. He would gladly give up all his toys if it meant he could have someone to play with.
All of a sudden, there is a knock at the door. Who could it be? Why, it's a little girl, the same age as Robin.
I'm Mary, your new next-door neighbour, she says. Would you like to play?
Oh, yes, please, says Robin.
He shows the little girl his favourite toy, his bow and arrow, of course. He teaches her how to hold them just so. Then the little girl fires an arrow. It flies through the air and hits the bullseye first time. Robin is so happy. At last he has someone to share his toys with. Cartoonito Tales, Treasure Island. Jim wishes he could be a pirate more than anything. He would love to sail the seven seas in search of treasure. He has even made his very own compass. But the arrow always points north, no matter which way it faces. On rainy days when Jim is stuck indoors, he likes nothing better than to hunt for treasure in his bedroom. He looks at his map and does an about turn. Then he follows his compass, one pace north and four paces east. It leads him straight to a little mouse hole in the skirting board. He reaches inside to look for treasure, and as he does, something very curious happens. The little mouse hole begins to grow bigger and bigger until there's just enough room to crawl through to the other side. No one, not even Jim, could have ever imagined there would be a ship sailing the seven seas hidden just behind the skirting board. The sails flap gently in the breeze as the ship bobs up and down on the rolling waves. Jim starts to explore. He is very excited to meet Captain Trelawney at the ship's wheel, even if he is a little clumsy. Trelawney has been lost at sea for many years.
I don't suppose you know how to use a compass, he asks.
I do, says Jim.
Do you have a map?
Asks Jim.
No, says Trelawney.
But surely there must be a map somewhere on board, says Jim.
They search high and low. Trelawney looks up at the sails. And Jim looks under the cannons. He finds bandanas and eye patches hidden there. Now they look like real pirates.
And what's this?
It isn't a map. But it is a flag of skull and crossbones. They hoist it up to the very top of the mast. Now it looks like a real pirate ship. All of a sudden, a big black storm cloud fills the sky. Crashing waves wash the little ship from side to side. Jim works hard to keep them afloat.
Secure the sail!
He shouts to Trelawney. They flap and fight against the wind. Out at sea, a mermaid is tangled up in a fishing net. She tries to wriggle free, but she only makes it worse. She waves to Trelawney for help. But he's no use at all. He just waves back. Jim comes to the rescue. He throws a rope to the mermaid. With Trelawney's help, he heaves her out of the swirling sea and onto the deck. The poor mermaid. The fishing net is wrapped round and round her beautiful silvery tail. But worst of all, she is frightened of pirates.
Don't worry, says Jim. We're good pirates.
And to prove it, they untangle the mermaid from the fishing net. At long last, the sun comes out, and it is calm at sea once more. The mermaid thanks Jim and Trelawney for their kind help. But all of a sudden, she bursts into tears.
Now I will never get to Treasure Island, she wails. It is so far away. Long John Silver is sure to get there first and steal all the treasure.
She shows them a map with an X to mark the spot where the treasure is buried. They are so excited.
Come with us, says Jim. We'll set sail for Treasure Island.
Jim proudly steers the boat over the seven seas. In no time at all, they have reached the sandy shore of Treasure Island. The mermaid dives into the sea with a flick of her silvery tail.
I'll stay here to guard the ship, she says.
Trelawney lowers the anchor. Then they climb off the ship and on to Treasure Island.
I'll lead the way, says Trelawney. I am the captain, after all.
He looks at the map with the X that marks the spot. But he doesn't know which way up it goes. And he doesn't know how the compass works. Trelawney just has to give up. He hands over the map and the compass.
This way to the treasure, says Jim.
They follow the map all the way to where the X marks the spot.
Oh no! The treasure chest has been dug up and all the treasure is gone! The mermaid will be so upset.
Look at these curious footprints in the sand. They can only belong to Long John Silver. He has a peg instead of a leg. Jim leads the way. They follow the footprints, hoping they will lead to the treasure. And sure enough, the footprints take them straight to Long John Silver and his first mate, Hans. They have a swag bag full of treasure. But Long John Silver's trusty parrot spots Jim and Trelawney sneaking up on them.
Beware, Captain!
He squawks. They draw swords ready to fight.
That treasure belongs to the mermaid, says Jim.
Never!
Says Long John Silver.
It's all mine!
All mine! All mine!
Squawks the parrot. Their swords clink and clash as they do battle on the beach. But luckily, the mermaid knows just what to do. She grabs the biggest shell she can find. Then she shouts to Jim to slash open the swag bag with his sword. The treasure rolls down the beach and into the shell. But the pirates don't even notice. They are too busy sword fighting. The mermaid heaves the shell full of treasure up onto the ship. But it doesn't take them very long to realise their swag bag has suddenly become very light indeed.
My treasure is all gone,
cries Long John Silver. Hans is so angry, he charges, but he trips over Trelawney. His sword flies through the air and gets stuck in a palm tree.
Now's our chance, shouts Jim. They run back to the ship as fast as they can.
They're getting away, Captain, Han shouts.
The mermaid heaves up the anchor. Being marooned on a desert island makes pirates feel just miserable. Their only love is the open sea. They set sail and promise to one day return, hoping that in time the pirates will have learned their lesson. The mermaid is so happy. Now she can share the treasure with all the creatures of the sea. And of course, Jim and Trelawney get a gold coin each for defeating Long John Silver. The mermaid promises to guide Trelawney back to dry land. But first, it's time to celebrate. They eat delicious ice cream and drink pineapple and coconut juice. They even sing sea shanties. Before long, Jim has to go home. He returns the golden compass and all the other things. Then he waves goodbye to his new friends before crawling through the mouse hole. Jim has had the most wonderful swashbuckling adventure, but he misses the seven seas terribly. But what's this? It's a golden compass, just like Trelawney's. Now Jim can have adventures of his very own. All he needs is a treasure map.
Cartoonito channel to see more from the shows you love. And remember, you can watch the latest full episodes on TV. But the fun doesn't stop there. Click or tap the play card to enjoy games, sing songs, and find activities.